What's up, everyone? So I really, really wanted to do this video because I thought it was just so extremely important. As you can see here, I have a book with me. Yes, it is Fundamentals of Special Strength Training, Yuri Verkhoshansky. And I believe this book was written 1986. At least that's the copyright on it. And I'm not really sure the actual publication date. Oh, 1977, I believe, actually, is when it was originally published. So bear that in mind, because the information you're about to read, if someone, well, I'm about to read to you, if someone went out and talked about now, oh, it's so ahead of its time, oh my gosh, wow, research hasn't caught up with us, stop it. Stop. That's silly. You just don't read any research. Read a book or two, it's good for you. You know what? Let me read a book to you. So, this is page 127. I'll put a link to this book, by the way, in my bio. I have no affiliation with anybody who sells this book. I just like this book. Let's read. So, this is starting off the chapter of kinetic energy. And by the way, I didn't give you any introduction. We're talking about shock method and plyometrics. And I'll read from this, and it's a tough read, so I'm going to do my best as I read through it to kind of explain it in some layman's terms because some of the jargon's pretty thick. We'll just start right off here. So, as I read to you, I feel like it's like class time. Let's consider, by the way, we're starting mid-chapter. If you guys at home, or for you guys to keep in track, it's 3.2.2. So kinetic energy. Let's consider the instance where a training apparatus, say a barbell, or in this case, maybe a human body too, has some velocity obtained as a result of falling from some height, and the sportsman task, sportsman being the athlete, task consists of first actively stopping it, then quickly thrusting it in the opposite direction, upward. An example would be like a medicine ball drop. Drop down, falling object, throw it up. Maybe you doing a drop jump off of a box, falling down, jumping back up. And now as I read this, I'm gonna skip through some paragraphs because I'm trying to get to the most important points here. So, as we continue. Principally, as regards to muscle dynamics, a peculiarity of such a movement is that in the amortization phase, that is the transition phase from eccentric to concentric, the kinetic energy of the apparatus is transformed into some potential muscular tension, which is utilized in the overcoming work. That falling energy transitions into concentric overcoming force. In principle, the magnitude of this potential is equal to the kinetic energy of the apparatus at the end of its fall. So the mass and the, if you think about momentum, I've talked about momentum on here before, you can think about kinetic energy momentum relationship or the velocity of it, of the fall from which it's coming from. So the higher the height, the more velocity it has. Mass times velocity is momentum. So the absolute muscular force developed at the instant of switching from yielding work, that eccentric, to overcoming will be greater the shorter the amortization path and the shorter the braking time. In other words, we've heard like ground contact times, right? A quick ground contact time, larger forces, larger impulse. Naturally, this applies to those conditions when the action as a whole is orientated to thrusting the apparatus with maximum speed immediately after it's being stopped. So, med ball throw, like the, you know, a drop you've probably seen, or a drop jump, try and jump as high as you can. Thus, what we are talking about is completely different from the traditional stimulation of muscular tension. The external mechanical irritant, the thing that actually creates the stimulus, is not so much the weight, it's not just load, right? We typically think about the irritant as load on the bar and its force of inertia as energy is accumulated after its fall. So it's the potential, actually the kinetic energy, the falling energy that's coming down. So that is the irritant, that is the stimulant. So let's jump ahead a little bit so we can keep this rolling here. The stimulation of muscular tension by means of absorbing the energy of the sportsman or athlete's falling body or a training apparatus can secure significant force of muscular contraction, parentheses, which is impossible with other means of mechanical stimulation, without using weight or with a small burden. And not only without slowing the speed of muscular contraction, but even increasing it in comparison to usual conditions. It is not difficult to see the even greater possibility of overcoming the fatal contradiction between external resistance and the speed of movement than in the aforementioned case where muscular strength is acting against the force of inertia and overcoming weight. So what it's saying basically is with a shock method, you're able to react to that kinetic energy that hits the ground, or you hitting the ground in that case, and it induces rapid amounts of force production and high velocity of muscle contraction. So as opposed to traditional weight loading where it's slow against a heavy load, this shock method is fast and forceful. So we're gonna skip ahead a little bit. Talks about some studies not pertinent to the situation at the moment. So, thus we are speaking of a specific work regime which no resistance exercise can imitate. Stimulation of muscular activity with resistance slows the movement from yielding to overcoming work. The utilization of energy of a falling body or apparatus for mechanical stimulation requires the muscles to initially develop significant potential tension, very important, overcoming the inertia of a relatively small weight, and then quickly switch to overcoming work and display a high speed of muscular contraction. So like we just said, it has to stop the momentum or the kinetic energy of the falling apparatus or the object that requires a large amount of force in a short period of time. That force which is developed, I keep doing a bench press example, has to then or can be then used to facilitate the concentric contraction against a lesser load because you're not pushing against a weighted object, you're pushing against that light object and you're producing rapid muscular contraction. So that's the difference, where we're using kinetic energy in this case versus weight. So I'll read a little bit more. Kinetic energy is determined by the weight of the body and the height of its fall. Therefore, in the interest of methodology, it's important to know how the stimulatory influence of energy changes. And it goes on to talk about how it's important to focus on the kinetic energy, the specifically maybe the magnitude and height in which you fall, so the velocity aspect of momentum relationship versus just weight. So we'll skip ahead. Apparently, this fact merits attention. Subsequent increases in the height of depth jump significantly lessens dynamic parameters of takeoff. When the depth jump is too high, there's too much momentum or kinetic energy. It doesn't help or boost augment the subsequent takeoff. The support time, ground contact time, increases quickly primarily because the instant of switching from yielding that eccentric to overcoming the concentric work is lengthened. The maximum dynamic force and the speed of muscular contraction stabilize. There is a clear division of takeoff into two action. The amortization phase, where you land, where the kinetic energy of the fall is absorbed, and then the thrust phase. So it's a two-part movement now because it's too demanding. So we need to make it a one-part movement. The amortization phase, that ground contact time, is characterized by the increasing depth of the squat and the thrust proper by a constant speed of muscular contraction. In other words, it's not facilitating the subsequent impact or the jump, and the impact is too great, so you're breaking it, and then you are jumping. So the positive effect of muscular stimulation by absorption of kinetic energy from a fall can be utilized successfully only under certain conditions. Taking into consideration the optimal heights of the fall, body weight, or weight of the apparatus, it goes on to talk about how you can better optimize this. When the muscle stimulation through the absorption of energy of a falling body or apparatus is a very effective method. The basis for it lies in the ability of the muscles to contract with more power after a sharp preliminary stretch, that impact. Nature created this mechanism, so it's innate to the human body, in order for man, the human, to successfully struggle with force of his body's inertia in extreme situations. They call this the survival mechanism. It is preserved well by utilization and practice of sport. So we see it in sport itself. I'm gonna skip ahead here really quick to our last bit. Preliminary stretching of the muscle has a place in a number of strength exercises, such as squats and jumps with a barbell on the shoulders. However, It is not as intense as breaking the velocity of a preliminary fall, which is characteristically sharp. So even if you're doing jumps with weight and stuff, it's still not necessarily the shock method. Therefore, the method of muscle stimulation by means of absorbing the kinetic energy of a fall was called the shock method. 1966, mind you, for all you people that say research isn't catching up with the times. Maybe you should read some research. Our research from 1958 to 1976 has taken only the first steps in studying and formulating this method. There's been a lot of research in the past that has corroborated the effectiveness of this method. However, much more work is needed. That's only like a page and a half, not even a page, probably one page in total. I've read a couple of paragraphs of this book. And basically what it tells us is that when we have kinetic energy, or you can think of it in terms of momentum, I like to think of it, and velocity, high velocity impacts, it offers a unique stimulus to the body from a neuromuscular standpoint. Tension is developed, or muscular force is developed from pier zero because you're in the air. You're not developing any force in the air unless we have some minor co-contraction, still minor in that sense. But then when you hit the ground, you have rapid shocking of the muscles that stretch, that creates an impact, a rapid stimulus to the neuromuscular system. So I wanted to share that with you guys. I love this book. There's so many of these great books out there. Go read a book, think about a book, ponder about a book, help your training methods because you learned a little bit more. That was, I'm not kidding, just a page of this wonderful text. And if you think science is behind, maybe you're behind on science. I appreciate you guys listening. I hope you enjoy. And if you stuck around this long, feel free to like, subscribe, comment, share this video, and thank you.